Man. That's what I'm talking about.
Well, praise the Lord, everybody. Come on, give God praise. Amen. He is worthy of the praise. Hallelujah. What a mighty God we serve. In Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Put your hands together one more time. Glorify His name. Amen. Let's pray. Father, we thank you tonight. We give you that praise and glory and honor for you. Alone, our God, we honor you and we praise you. We ask that you remove unhindered in this place. We ask that your word will saturate our hearts and minds, that we might walk upright before you. We would hide the word of God within our heart, and that we would do the things that you have called us to do in this season. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
All right. Get your Bibles out. Hope you brought something to write with, because we're going to be taking some notes tonight. And I don't know about you, but there are things in my life, you know, periodically that I just wanted to change. Amen. And if you're going to be saved, you're going to have to change.
Amen.
Amen. It's all to that, amen. You're gonna have to make some changes, amen. Get your Bibles, go to the book of Ephesians. Ephesians chapter 4, and I want to bring your attention to the 22nd verse, and this is going to be our foundation scripture for tonight. If you have it, say amen. And tonight I want to talk to you a little about spiritually changing your life and renewing your mind. Spiritually changing your life and renewing your mind. Say that with me. Spiritually
changing
my life
and
renewing my mind. Verse 22 of Ephesians chapter 4. And then you put off concerning the former conversation the old man. Somebody say the old man, which is corrupt. So the Bible said the old man is corrupt according to his deceitful lust, and be renewed in the spirit of your mind. Mm-hmm. And that you put on the new man, which after God is created in righteousness and true holiness, not religious holiness, but true holiness.
Amen.
Wherefore, putting away lying,
amen,
speak every man the truth with his neighbor, for we are members one of another. Be angry and sin not. Let not the sun go down upon your wrath, neither give place to the devil. Let him that stole steal no more, but rather let him labor, working with his hands the things which is good, that he may have to give to him that needeth.
Amen.
Let no corrupt communication proceed out of your mouth, but that which is good for the use of edifying, that it may minister grace unto the hearers. And grieve not the Holy Spirit of God, whereby you are sealed unto the day of redemption. Let all bitterness and wrath and anger and clamor and evil speaking be put away from you with all malice. And be kind one to another.
Amen.
Tenderhearted.
Amen.
Forgiving one another. Even as God, for Christ's sake, hath forgiven you. Say amen.
Amen.
So I want to really deal with some things tonight. And I pray you brought something to write with. Because we're going to be dealing with some very important issues. Spiritually changing your life. And you want to change. You want to grow spiritually. Amen. Spiritually changing your life and renewing your mind. So the first thing I need you to jot down is that you can only prosper off of what is authentically in you. You can only prosper off of what's really in you, your core, who you really are. If any man be in Christ, he is a new creation. So you can't prosper, you'll never prosper off of the things that you gather. Amen, somebody. You can only gather off of, you can only prosper off of who you are. Amen. So an apple tree, an apple core has to produce what?
Apples.
Amen, somebody. Now you can fix it up a little bit and make pretty apples and green apples. Amen, somebody. Macintosh apples, but they are still, right? And one of the things you're going to have to understand is that you will never prosper until you learn how to be what you were created to be. All right? So you got to understand that when God created you, He created you after the likeness of God in righteousness and true holiness. Amen, somebody. And you will never really produce until you learn to find out what's in you. You will never really prosper. Amen, somebody. So you can only prosper off of what is authentically in you, nothing fake. You got to, somebody's going to be real.
Got to be real.
The second thing I want you to write down is that you cannot make great withdrawals if you've never had great deposits.
Huh. Amen.
So if you have a little deposit, you can't make a great withdrawal. In other words, if you only put $5 in the bank, you can't go in there and get $100. Amen. So why are you telling me this, Pastor? I'm telling you this because if you don't invest in your core, you're not going to get nothing out. Amen, somebody. And you need great withdrawal. Right? So you don't want to just be an apple seed, you want to be an apple orchard, right? But if you don't ever invest in you spiritually, you can never make great withdrawals. Hallelujah. And it's a shame, a lot of times people don't understand how important it is that if you start investing in you, you'll have time to worry about what other folk are doing.
Come on now. Tell the truth, Pastor.
Amen. Tell your neighbor, say neighbor.
Neighbor.
What you invest in.
What you invest in.
Ephesians chapter 3, verse 2. Let's go there right quick. Ephesians chapter 3, verse 2. So you got to figure out what's in you. Who am I and what has God given me to work with? Who am I? And what has God given me to work with? Hallelujah. And you should spend your time investing in who God made you to be.
Amen.
Somebody say amen.
Amen.
Verse number 2, Ephesians chapter 3 says, now unto him that is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we could what? Y'all got it? Y'all talking to me? Ephesians chapter 3, verse 2. Let's try it again. Now unto him that is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we could what? Ask or what? So he's saying he's able to do anything above you, abundantly above all. Oh, I'm reading. I'm sorry. And then verse 22 is what I want. I must have erased something in. Okay. Let me see.
Ephesians 3:20.
Thank you. All right, so he's able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we could what? According to what? So it's according to what? So it's not according to just what you ask or think. It's according to what's working in you. Somebody say amen to that.
Amen.
And so, if there's nothing working in you, hallelujah, glory to God. If there's nothing at work in you, I'm not talking about something working on you, I'm talking about what's at work in you.
Amen.
Hallelujah. If there's nothing working in you, He's not able to do it exceedingly abundantly above all that you can even ask or think, because he's doing it according to the power that's working in you. Hallelujah, somebody. And what's the power that's working in you? The power of the Word of God, the power of the Holy Ghost. Amen, somebody. What's working in you? What kind of power do you? Is it the power of the world, or is it the power of God working in you? Amen, somebody. All right, Philippians chapter 2. Ask yourself, say self.
Yeah.
What's in you?
What's in you?
So, remember I told you, if you don't make a deposit in you, you can't make a withdrawal. So if there ain't nothing in you, you can't get nothing out of you.
That's right.
Amen. Philippians chapter number 2. Hallelujah. Let this mind be where?
In
who?
In me.
In you as it what? Which was also in Christ Jesus. So the mind, somebody say the mind.
The mind.
The mind is your steering wheel that determines the direction of your destiny and life. Then we are transforming our lives by the way we turn our mind. Amen, somebody. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. So you got to turn your mind toward the things of God. Y'all just work with me. I'm going to take you somewhere. You got to turn your mind toward the things of God. Am I in the right church?
Amen.
Because if you're going to change your life spiritually, you're going to have to do it by changing your mind.
Amen.
Am I in the right church? So if you're going to prosper, it's going to be that you prosper in your mind before it hits your wallet.
Amen. Amen. Good.
Somebody say amen.
Amen.
You're going to have to turn your mind first before you turn your finances. Glory to God. If you're going to break a habit, whether it's smoking or drinking or whatever it may be, it's going to happen in your mind before it happens in your body.
Stay at first.
All right. So, you want to spiritually change your life by renewing your mind. I want to spiritually change my life. There is so much that you could avoid in the future if you would handle your business now. Amen. That there's some things that you could avoid if you just take care of it now. I wish I had somebody here.
Amen.
So the Bible, throughout the Bible, is illustrated over and over again, and the Holy Spirit releases His power the moment that you take the step of faith. For example, when Joshua was faced with the impassable barrier of crossing the floodwaters of the Jordan River, it was when they put their foot in the water and stepped in, amen, by obeying God, that the rushing current, amen, subsided and receded. And it receded based on their obedience. Amen? And so, if you're going to change your life spiritually, it's going to start by you walking by faith. Tell somebody it's going to happen by faith. So Paul here in this text that we just read in Ephesians chapter 4, he's explaining three major responsibilities. Number one is that we're going to have to change the way that we think.
Amen.
Let the Spirit change the way that you're thinking. The Bible says that we are transformed by the renewing of our minds. We're going to read that later in Romans chapter 12, verse 2. The Greek word for transformed is metamorphosis.
Amen.
It's what happens when a caterpillar moves into the cocoon and comes out a butterfly. He is transformed. Amen. Ephesians, let's go back to Ephesians chapter 4. So we've got to learn how to let God direct our thoughts.
Amen.
And we've got to learn how to let God change us from the inside out. So verse 22, Ephesians chapter 4, if you're back there, say amen. So he says, first of all, that we put off the conversation of the former, that we put off concerning the former conversation of the old man, which is what?
Grows corrupt.
Corrupt. Amen, somebody. And so your old man is what?
Corrupt.
What is he?
Corrupt.
What is he?
Corrupt.
So you can't trust him, can you?
No,
why? Because he's what?
Corrupt.
He's corrupt, ain't he?
No good.
Amen, somebody. He's flat out no good. So the Bible says, put off the conversation with the old man. So put off means that there must be some changes.
Amen.
He's telling you, you got to make some changes. Amen. There's got to be some very significant changes. Hallelujah. So we got to let go of some old stuff. Tell somebody, let go, let go.
Let go, let go.
Let go of some old stuff. The word conversation means behavior. So when he's saying put off the old conversation, he's not just talking about talking. He's talking about behavior. So the King James word conversation might throw you off a little bit. He's not talking about what you say. He's talking about how you behave. Your behavior is linked to how you think.
Amen.
Are you with me?
Amen.
And how you think is linked to what's in your heart. Proverbs 23, verse number 7. Write it down in your notes. You don't have to turn there. It says, for as he thinketh in his heart, so is he. Are you with me? So the scripture is telling us that we have to put off the old man and put off the conversation or the behavior. So that means you got to change your behavior. So that means when you get saved, you don't continue to act like you used to act.
Amen.
Amen, somebody. But you cannot stop acting like you used to act until something is transformed in your
mind.
In your mind.
Amen.
Upstairs.
Amen. Remember I told you, it don't hit your body until it gets in your head. Are y'all with me?
Amen.
And so, Matthew chapter 12, let's turn there right quick. So he says, put off the conversation and be renewed in the spirit of your mind. So he's telling you not to just put off the old man or the old behavior, but he's saying you can't do it unless you're renewed in the spirit of your mind. Are you with me?
Amen.
He says, put off the old behavior, but he's also saying you cannot do that unless you are renewed in the spirit of your mind. So you won't be able to make the changes spiritually that you need to make unless your mind is renewed. Are you with me? All right. I'm going to talk to you a little bit about how to get your mind in the right place.
Help.
All right. Matthew chapter 12, verse 34 says, O generation of vipers, how can you, being evil, speak good things?
Amen.
For out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. Are you with me?
Amen.
And so you got to understand that your behavior is linked to your thinking, and your mouth is linked to your mind. Hallelujah. Are you with me? For out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. And there goes your life. I wish I had a witness in here.
Amen.
So putting off the former things of the former conversation of the old man and being renewed in your mind. The Bible says in Romans 6:6, knowing this, that the old man is crucified with him, that the body of sin might be destroyed, and henceforth we should not serve sin. 2 Corinthians 5:17 says, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. Colossians 3:9 says, lie not one to another, seeing that you have put off the old man with his deeds. So the object here is that we get rid of the old man. And that we put on the new man.
Amen.
But that only happens when our mind is what? Renewed. Amen, somebody. So somebody say, put off the old man.
Put off the old man.
So to put off the old man means to resist his lust.
Amen.
Tell your neighbor, say, neighbor.
Neighbor.
Put him off.
Put him off.
Say it again, put him off.
Put him off.
So write this down. When I say put off, it means don't gratify your flesh.
Amen.
Have you ever put something off? Have you ever tabled something?
Yes.
What happens though, most believers put off spiritual things.
Amen.
And put on carnal.
Amen.
What God is saying, I want you not to put off the spiritual. I want you to put off the flesh. Hold your flesh off and start putting your attention and your time on spiritual things.
Amen.
Amen, somebody. So he's saying, put off the flesh.
Put off the flesh.
And put on spiritual things.
Put on the spiritual.
Are you with me?
Amen.
Romans 8:5. Turn there with me right quick. So I want to put on spiritual things. I want to put off doing carnal things.
Amen.
Amen. I want to put off the stuff that my flesh enjoys, and I want to start doing the things that my spirit needs.
That's
right. Romans 8:5 says, for they that are after the flesh do what? Mind the things of the flesh. But they that are after the spirit, things of the spirit. So if you want to grow spiritually, and if you want to spiritually change your life, then your mind and your attention has to be more focused on spiritual things than carnal. The word carnal, all carnal means is flesh. Something that is motivated by the lust of your own flesh. It's rooted in fleshly desire, what you can feel, what you can taste, what you can handle. Amen, somebody. It's sensory motivated. Amen. Spiritual, to walk in the spirit means I'm motivated by faith and not by sight. Amen.
Amen.
So I got to put on the new man. I got to put off the old man.
Good.
And that you put on the new man, the Bible says, which is after Christ, which is after God, which is created in righteousness and true holiness. So there's a new person in you who is created after God in righteousness. This man is renewed in knowledge. Colossians 3:10 says, put on the new man, which is renewed in the knowledge after the image of him that created him. So you got to walk in the newness of life, in the newness of the knowledge of God. In other words, the new man is renewing his mind to God, or constantly refreshing his mind in God. So this is what you've got to understand. When you get born again, Your mind has to be refreshed constantly in the things of God.
Amen.
Are you with me?
Yes, sir.
His mercies are new every morning. You every day you have to refresh yourself. Amen. In the things of God. And what happens is that if you don't refresh yourself in the things of God every day, that old man who is corrupt will begin to what? Surface. Amen, somebody. And his appetite is not for God, but it's for the what? It's for the flesh. So every day when you refresh yourself or renew your mind to the things of God. Amen, somebody. And the more you refresh yourself, the more your life begins to be what? Transformed. Amen. The more you refresh yourself, the more it becomes. Who in here is graduated? You know, you out of high school.
Amen.
Walk back up into high school right now. Amen. And so the first thing you're gonna need is a what? A refresher course. Huh? It's not that you didn't go through it. You're just not refreshed in it. Do you understand what I'm saying? Making good sense? And so since you're not refreshed in it, you don't gravitate to it. Amen. Right? How many here used to be able to do multiplication like...
Ain't doing no
more. Hey, remember that timetable chart we used to get? Maybe y'all
see
y'all. You had it memorized.
Amen.
Right?
Try
that now. So you could go 5 times 5 is 25. Right? You could go up to the 12s. Do it now.
Amen. Oh my.
Amen, somebody. And so you gravitate to things away from the spirit, and you gravitate to things that are in the flesh. That would make a good sense.
Amen.
You're not living from who you are.
Amen.
Some part of you still wants to be accepted.
Right.
You gotta understand something. That if you got saved the Bible way, the Bible says you can walk through witches. Amen. The Bible says you can touch anything and it won't hurt you. So you're not affected by what's outside. Amen, somebody. So you've got to understand, when you're on your job, you don't have to compromise. You are who you are.
Right,
you got to know who you are.
Amen.
You got to know who God made you to be.
Amen.
Amen. You are the influence, not them.
Amen.
Amen, somebody. You are the difference maker.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
And so when you get up in the morning and you've prayed and you've been in your word, amen. Then you're walking the way God wants you to walk. The Bible says if you walk in the spirit, you will not fulfill the lust of your flesh. I don't care if it's on your job, or wherever the case may be. If you walk in the spirit, the Bible says you will not fulfill the lust of your flesh.
That's good.
Amen. Yeah. Let me say this to you. First of all, stop going places wanting to be accepted.
Don't be talking about your job.
Okay, where it is. Okay. Jesus said, you're going to lose your mama, your daddy, your brother, your sister. No, it's not that you don't need them. Don't get me wrong. Listen, don't misunderstand me. Right? We walk in love. But we're not there to be accepted. I've been accepted, the Bible says, in the beloved.
Amen.
All right? And so you're going to have to accept who you are. Accept the fact that you are rejected by the, you are going to be rejected by the world. All right, don't be shocked or surprised when you're not accepted. Stop tripping over that. It's who you are.
Amen.
Amen, somebody.
Amen.
And you've got to understand that you got to grow spiritually. I was talking with one of them. Let me finish teaching my lesson. Because I don't want to get off point like I did last night. I got to get this too. I was telling one of my overseers for the fellowship, listen, you got to be able to deal with criticism. And some criticism is true. Amen. You got to take the meat, spit out the bones, and keep it moving. All criticism ain't because of haters. It is because you are like you are. Amen, somebody. You've got to learn how to live in the realm that God created you to live in. Stop trying to fit other people's mold.
Amen.
Be a Christian. Be a believer.
Amen.
Be the man or the woman that God called you to be. And let God deal with the rest.
Amen.
Walk in love. Walk in peace.
Right.
Walk in integrity. Keep your word. Do the things you said you was going to do. Amen. Walk. In other words, if they need help, help them.
Amen.
But you ain't got to try to please them.
Right.
Because you can't be who you are and who God called you to be and be what they want you to be. You're going to have to choose.
Amen.
All right? And if your choice is to be who God called you to be, then be man enough or woman enough to live with the choice.
Amen.
And if my choice means that you won't like me, amen, somebody.
Amen.
Because my choice is stronger than your indignation. My choice is stronger than your hatred.
Amen.
Amen. And if their choice, if they're what they feel about you is rocking your world, you need to do a check.
Amen.
I'm just being real with you. If their choice and what they think about you is affecting you, you need to check yourself.
I know.
You need to have a talk with you. Amen, somebody. That makes good sense. Amen. Oh, yeah, you got a question?
And I
didn't know if you was shouting or if you was...
I was doing both, but that's lining up with your spiritual walk, correct?
Yeah.
I mean, if your choice just ain't your choice because of who you are, but we're talking about your choice as to lining up with who God says you are as it relates to your spirit, as it relates to your spirit, man.
Right. Doing the things that you need to do. Amen, somebody. Amen. And your life is the sum total of the choices that you make. And like I said, what you do now is going to affect your future.
Amen.
That's why you want to make changes now spiritually. So you can avoid some stuff.
Amen.
I wish I had a witness in here. So tell your neighbor, this is a step of faith. It's a step of faith. It's a step. It's a step of faith. Amen. All right. So let's go a little deeper. I want to Write this down. Because all of us have weak points, right? All of us have things that we want changed, amen? God wants you to act first. Don't wait until you feel powerful or confident. Move ahead in your weakness, doing the right thing in spite of your fears, in spite of your feelings. Because when you do that, this is how you cooperate with the Holy Ghost. So, as you're trying to move toward change, you're going to have to allow yourself to understand that I'm not where I want to be, but I'm not going to stay where I am. Amen? Yes. You can't move ahead of God.
Well, you know what I mean.
No.
Like moving too fast. How do you differentiate that? If I don't feel like, or if I don't think that I'm where I need to be to move ahead, how do I do that without moving before God and say, okay, go?
Well, God is always saying go when it comes to developing your character. This is not about moving into a position or something. This is about dealing with your behavior and who you are as a person. And so there's not a time where God doesn't want you to start changing and working on you. There's not a day you got to wait. So there may be some frailties and some weaknesses in your life, and you don't know how to work on those things quite perfectly yet. Just because you don't know how to work on them perfectly yet does not mean that you don't take a step of faith and begin to attack these things. Listen, let me say something to you. You cannot conquer what you will not confront.
That's good. Amen.
Amen. And if you know there's some things about your life that needs to change, it will not change. But you're just wishing that it changes. You're going to have to do something. But sometimes you don't know where to start. God says, just start somewhere. Am I making good sense? Am I making good sense? And so what God wants you to do is begin to cooperate. Say, Lord, I'm going to cooperate with you. I don't really know all the details of how you want me to work this out, but I'm not going to stay like this.
Amen.
So I'm moving forward. Amen. And as I begin to move forward, God's going to do some things in your life to help you get to the place that you need to get to. So if you hooked on drugs, there's not a place where you got to find a place to start. You just start. Amen, somebody. Am I making good sense? God wants you to begin to make some effort by faith on your. You want your life to change? Take a step towards change.
Amen.
Making good sense? All right. All right, so let's go back to Ephesians chapter number 4. Let's look at verse 25. We're going to choose to let some things go. We have to put off the old man. Everything that is connected with the old way of life has to go.
Amen.
So now that I'm saved, old things have what? All things have become what? So God doesn't want you to live the way you was living. Amen, somebody. So watch this. Verse 25. Wherefore putting away what? Lying. Speak every man the truth to his neighbor. For we are members one of another. Be angry and do what?
Sin not.
Let not the sun go down upon your wrath. So what's the sin? Letting the sun go down on your wrath. In other words, he's asking you before the sun. When you get angry, forgive that person before you go to bed. Amen, somebody. Neither give place to who? Neither give place to the devil. Let him that stole, steal no more. But let him rather give unto him that needeth. Let no corrupt communication proceed out of your mouth, but that which is good to the use of edifying, that it may minister grace unto the hearers. Grieve not the Holy Spirit of God, whereby you are sealed, unto the day of redemption. Let all bitterness and wrath and anger and clamor and evil speaking be put away from you with all malice. Be ye kind to one another, tenderhearted, loving one another, even as God, for Christ's sake, has forgiven you. So God says, listen, you're going to have to take these things and you're going to have to put them away from you. So this scripture is clearly telling you that once you get saved, God is expecting you to do what? I can't hear y'all talking. So he wants your life to do what? Does God want you to stay the same? So when you are, listen, when you are not saved, you're subject to sickness, disease, poverty. You are under the thumb of the enemy. When you get born again, God says your life has what? So why does God want you to change your behavior? Because he wants you to begin to behave like the change that has happened in your life. Amen, somebody. And so the things that God is telling you to get rid of is not conducive to the change that he says already. The change that he says that's taking place, you received it by what?
Faith.
You didn't see it. You received it by
faith.
So now he's telling you these are the actions that faith without
right.
works is what?
Yes.
So he's telling you these are the works
right.
that you must do. Amen, somebody. Can I go a little deeper? Hallelujah. So God is saying, the rich of the kingdom don't do these things. They don't have to. Hallelujah. If you're rich, you don't need to lie. I don't need to cheat. If I'm rich, I don't need to steal. I don't have to cut corners. I don't have to do those things because of who I am in the... Right? So if I've been changed into an apple seed, an apple core, if the core of who I am is an apple, I don't have to do what the watermelon do. That would make a good sense. That's not me. Stop. Listen. Listen. God says, be who I ordained you to be and stop acting like what you were, because he said what you were is dead. All right. Let me go a little deeper because I don't want to run out of time tonight. I got to get Romans chapter 6. So he's telling you to take off the old stuff and develop new habits. Somebody say new habits.
New habits.
You must put on the character of Christ by developing new habits, new godly habits. Your character, write this down, my character is the sum or the essential sum of my habits. So what I read to you earlier in Ephesians chapter number 4, verse 25, beginning verse 25, are old habits. Lying, stealing, cheating. Those are old habits. Right? God is saying, okay, your old habits have to go. Now I'm going to put you into a place where you have to have new godly habits.
Amen.
So you got to put on the new you.
Amen.
New life is abundant life. Say that with me. New life, is abundant life. Now you cannot live a new life and your old life simultaneously. That's why Jesus said you cannot take new wine and pour it into an old wineskin. Because when the wine begins to ferment, the old wineskin cannot stretch enough to accommodate the process. See, when they put the wine in the wineskin, it had to ferment. And when it would ferment, it would stretch the wineskin. So the wineskin had to be new. If they poured it in an old wineskin, it had already been stretched as far as it could go. It was fixed. No room for growth. And a lot of believers are fixed. You can't make them grow. It's just fixed. And if you pour something new in it, it gets so fixed that during the process, it busts. And so now listen, the wineskin is ruined and the wine is wasted. So God says, listen, I'd rather just keep the wineskin them both ways, the wineskin and the wine. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
So I want to walk, the Bible says, in the newness of life. Watch this, Romans chapter 6, verse 4. Therefore we are buried with him by baptism unto death, that like as Christ was raised up from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we should walk in the what? So the newness of life is the abundant life. Jesus came that you might have what?
Life.
So this newness of life, tell somebody this is new. Amen. So me not lying no more. When I got saved, that was what? That was new. Amen. I want to talk to you. I was a drinker. Now I don't drink no more. That's what? Amen, somebody. I had a real bad temper, but now I'm mellow. That's something. Amen, somebody. That's why people who used to know you back in the day don't really know you now, because you are somebody. Amen, somebody. So don't tell me that you're saved and you ain't got nothing new to offer. Amen, somebody. That you the same old person. You doing the same old stuff. You ain't got nothing new coming. All right. Isaiah chapter number 26. So the old life is filled with lack and worry. Your new life, if any man is in Christ, he is a new creature. Behold, all things become, old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. Whom Jesus has set free is what? Free indeed. Old life, I'm in bondage. New life, I'm in freedom. Can I get a witness of you? So, they that are after the flesh mind the things of the flesh, right? And if you mind the things of the flesh, you're going to have disease, poverty, worry, stress, strife. I can just go down the list, right? But if you mind the things of the Spirit, you'll have life, you'll have peace. It's where is your head? Where do you turn your mind? When you get home and you get off of work, does your mind turn to TV and scandal and foolishness? Does your mind turn to Facebook? Does your mind turn to the phone? Where does your mind go? Does it go carnal? People have a tendency to want to try to steer their mind spiritually on Sunday, you know, or when they get in trouble and they need a miracle. Then they want to be what? Spiritual. Right? But God is saying you got to mind the things of the Spirit so that you'll have this new life all the time. Not just like, you know, in case of emergency, break glass. Amen, somebody. So God wants you to have this new life when? 24. But it doesn't have 24/7 if your mind is mostly in your flesh, right? So if your mind is in your flesh all the time, then your life experiences are going to be the result of a person who is carnal. And what you really want to do is that you want to change your life spiritually. And the only way that you can change your life spiritually is to have your mind renewed. Amen, somebody. You can't do that once a month or once a week. That's a lifestyle. Are you with me? Isaiah chapter number 26. So the Bible says here in 26, Isaiah 26 and 3, thou shalt keep him in what? Who's what? Stayed on TV. So where does your mind have to stay? It has to stay in the spirit. Your thoughts. That's why the Bible says in 2 Corinthians chapter 10, bringing every thought into captivity to obedience. You got to get a hold of your head. Stop blaming other people for your downfalls and mistakes and the problems in your life. Get a hold of your head, because some of the folk that you're blaming shouldn't even been in your life in the first place had you had your mind in the right spot. Amen, somebody. If I had a head, had had my head in the right place, there's some people I wouldn't even know. Amen, somebody. I was saved when I met my son's mother, and I didn't meet her at church. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Instead of praying and being in my word, I was frustrated, and I decided, well, bump this Christian stuff. I'm gonna go back out to the club. And what the world I do that for? Uh-oh. Because I was minding my flesh and not the... Y'all don't want to talk to me. I ain't never did that. Okay. Now, this is many, many years ago. I'm just trying to tell you. I wouldn't have never met her. Y'all not hearing me. There's some people that would have never been in your life had you done what you were supposed to be doing spiritually. I know I'm right about it. You say, why are you telling me this now, Pastor? I'm telling you this so you don't have a future like your past. You want to change your life? Who want to keep going around this merry-go-round? Huh? Who want to keep riding this ride? Well, you can't get off this ride unless you steer your mind off. You can't just live any old kind of way.
Amen.
You can't live in your flesh and have the benefits of being a man or woman of God the way that God really wants to bless you if you're going to have these old habits, because these old habits are going to sum up your life. They're going to be the total sum of your character.
Amen.
Amen, somebody. All right. Psalms 119. Let's go there and I'll get out your way. I'm just going to give you 3-4 more scriptures. And I got to get out your way. Psalms 119. I'm sorry, Psalms 19. Psalms 19. Thank you, Holy Ghost. If you got it, say amen. Let the words of my mouth and the what? Be what? Amen. So let the words of my mouth and the meditation to meditate, to concentrate on, to focus. Somebody say meditate. Verse 14. So the meditation. Now, the word meditate means to murmur. But you're repeating it over and over. It's a repetition of speaking the word of God until it gets into your heart. Another word for your heart, until it gets into your
mind.
It becomes part of you. Amen, somebody. So what he's talking about here is that I'm focused on God. I'm focused on God's word. He says, so let my meditation be what? So everything that you meditate or focus on ain't acceptable. So David is saying, I want what I'm thinking about and what my head is on and what my focus is on to be something that is acceptable with God. Well, what's acceptable to God? God wants you to be in peace. God wants you to have joy. God wants you to have life. God wants you to have health. Amen, somebody. So God wants you meditating on the things of God that's going to bring those things to you. I always had somebody here. God wants your head concentrating on the things of God that's going to bring the things that God wants for you to you. So he says, let the meditation and the word of my mouth be what? Amen. That's why the Bible says that you have to have your mind renewed that you might prove what is the good, acceptable, and perfect will of God. Amen. So Lord, I want to do what's acceptable. What do you want for my life? That's where I want to concentrate my effort. Remember I told you that if you don't invest, you can't make a withdrawal. So if you don't put any effort into those areas of your life, you're not going to get anything out of it. If all you ever invest in is your flesh and your desires and trying to get immediate gratification for every little thing in your life, if you can't tell your body no, so that you can, if you can't turn off your television and turn down your plate, y'all don't want to talk back to me now. Amen, somebody. If you can't put your ringer off your phone and spend some time in your word and with God, if all you know how to do is gratify your flesh, amen, somebody, you won't have the spiritual benefits of being a believer, because your concentration is in the flesh, and the only benefits that you're going to really reap is that of a sinner. And then you wonder why my life has not changed, even though I've been what? Born again. Because the preachers don't want to challenge you. But if I don't challenge you, you're going to have the same benefits that you had even before you got saved. Who wants that? Amen, somebody. Watch this. Matthew. Let's go to Luke and Matthew. Luke chapter 6 and Matthew chapter 12. So let the meditation of my heart. Somebody say my heart.
My heart.
Somebody say my mind.
My mind.
Somebody say the good treasure.
The good treasure.
Of my mind.
Of my mind.
So what's in your mind is what's going to be in your life.
That's right.
Does your mind have a good treasure or a bad one?
Hello.
And if you fill your mind with junk, your life going to be filled with junk. What's in your mind? Ask yourself, say self.
Self.
What's on your mind?
What's on your mind?
Oh, mind. God, my God.
What's on upstairs?
Luke chapter 6, verse 45. Now these are two scriptures that are going to be quite similar, but there's some differences between Luke and Matthew that I want to point out, and then I'm going to get out your way. Luke 6 and 45 says, a good man, out of the good treasure of his heart, bring forth what? That which is what? So he's saying, if you got good stuff in your head, you'll bring out that which is what? An evil man, out of the evil treasure of his heart, bring forth that which is what? So he's saying, if it's in your head, if it's in your heart, it'll be in your mouth, it'll be in your life. For out of the abundance of the heart, he says, the mouth speaks. So he says, the good treasure comes out through your, 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 and your mouth is really guided by what's in your heart. And your heart is guided by your meditation. And what you meditate on will develop the habits in your life. Amen. And your habits develop your character, and your character is who you are. And whoever you are at the core is what you're gonna, whatever you are at the core is what you're gonna withdraw from. And so if you're trying to make a healthy, heavy withdrawal spiritually from your core, and all you ever have been is in the flesh, when you reach in to pull out something spiritual, it ain't, you, listen, it ain't gonna be there. All right, Matthew chapter 12. Verse 34, he says, O generation of vipers, how can ye, being evil, speak good things? So I told you, out of the treasure of your heart or the treasure of your mind comes good things or bad things, and they come out through your mouth. Amen, somebody. So an evil heart is produced by evil company. Write that down. An evil heart is produced by evil company. So here's my thing. You can be saved, born again, and have an evil heart. Because of the time you spend with evil things. It's filtered into your heart. It's in your mind. And so even though you are saved, your heart is evil. And so since your heart is evil, now your conversation is evil. And all that you can pull out is what? Evil. So I want to give you this. Write this down. The word evil in the Greek means worthless or deprived. So even though you're saved, love the Lord, but you've got this evil company that you keep. And what I mean by evil company, I'm not talking about people. Huh? You listening to that foolishness on the radio?
Amen.
The things around you, because listen, I'm the kind of person that I don't need the company of people. But I do have company. There's something that you do or like that keeps you company.
Amen.
How do you entertain yourself? What do you do with your time?
Amen.
You keep in company with something. Oh, I know I'm right about it. Amen, somebody. What's running through your head when you're alone? So when I talk about evil company, I'm not just talking about friends. I'm not just talking about people. I'm talking about the things that you spend time with.
Amen.
That have absolutely, positively nothing to do with God.
Amen.
And at the end of the day, your investment, because you've invested yourself, right? After you spent your time, it's an investment. And the Bible says if it's evil, then it's worthless. What he's telling you is you will get nothing out of it. You will not enjoy anything out of it. So God is saying you better off spending time with me. Spending time in my word, because when you invest in that, he is a rewarder of them that diligently. Y'all are going to talk to me here.
Amen.
You ain't got time to work on it. Don't tell me you work. Please don't say that to me. You better do it. You ain't got time to be playing with this thing. You got to make up your mind. Either I'm going to go left. When you're steering your car, you can't be talking about, well, I don't know which way I'm about. How would you look driving down the street? Well, do it. Get it. You ain't got time to play. Amen, somebody. So I'm doing this thing. That should be your confession. That's what I'm doing. Amen, somebody. I'm moving in that direction. I've made a choice. Hallelujah. Because at the end of the day, I want to have the life that God has ordained for me. I want my life to change spiritually, and I know the only way for my life to change spiritually is I'm going to have to renew my mind. The only way that I can renew my mind is that I'm going to have to meditate on the thing. I'm going to spend more energy and more time with the Word of God in prayer. I'm going to spend more time saturating my life with the spiritual things and not carnal things.
Amen.
I'm going to have to refocus, adapt, and readjust myself so that I can do the things that God has called me to do.
Amen.
That makes a good sense. Amen. Who in here wants to really live a better life. That's it? Just okay. I'm serious business right now. Amen. Well, it won't happen unless you make some very serious decisions about your future. Amen. Because where you are and the things that you've experienced up to this point is based on the decisions that you have been making from your past. Making good sense? Right? So now, you want your future to be brighter, to be better, to be happier, to be more fulfilled. You want your latter to be greater than your former. Am I in the right church? You want more peace? Am I in the right church? You want more joy? Am I in the right place? You want more power? You want more peace? You want more prosperity? You want health in your life? You want your children to be blessed? You want your fruit to be blessed? You want to be blessed in the city? You want to be blessed in the field? Well, you're going to change your habits. Amen, somebody. And you're going to get down in Ephesians chapter 4 and say, I'm going to put off the old man. I got to put him off. He's always going to be around, but I'm going to put him. You ever had that call from that bill collector? You know how to put somebody off.
Amen.
Y'all not going to talk to me.
Amen.
You ever had that person to call you? You know they want something and you don't want to give it to them? You know how to put them off. Am I in the right church? Well, that's your flesh. You need to put it what? Tell somebody you can put it off. Put it off? If you put it off long enough, after a while it don't bother you no more. Hallelujah. But you cannot put that off and not put on something. The Bible says that when an evil spirit has gone out of a man and walketh about in dry places, and when it findeth no rest, it returneth to the place from which it was cast out. And when it see the place swept and garnished. In other words, there's nothing been replaced. Amen, somebody. So you can't just put that off and not put something on. So you put off the old man, but you got to put on the new man, and you got to walk in the newness of life. So where evil was, there's goodness. Where lying was, there's now truth. Amen. Where there was worry and grief, there's now peace. Y'all don't want to talk to me in here. Amen, somebody. Where there was lack, now there's what? Prosperity. You got to replace it. Amen, somebody. Where there was sickness, there's now what? Health and healing. Oh my God. We don't leave the ground barren. Amen. Say, Lord, work on me. Come on, stand on your feet. I'm through. So I think I made a case that you just can't live any old kind of way. That God didn't save you for you to stay like you were. I think I made a case out of the Word of God that you need to do what? Change. And that's not something the pastor's preaching. That's something that God's saying he wants done. God wants you to do what? And the reason that he wants you to change is that he knows that once you begin to move towards those changes are going to come out to your benefit, that you will have a what? Blessed life. Amen, somebody. God said, this is how the citizens of the kingdom behave. Hallelujah. God wants you to have good, not evil. Hallelujah. So you need to change your mind. You need to shift your thinking. Glory to God. You got to get out of this mentality of not having enough and that I can't do it. Amen, somebody. You got to get your mind right. Say, Lord, help me get my mind right. Amen, somebody. Better get a hold of your head. Because if you give a place to the devil, he's going to drive you crazy.
Amen.
Amen, somebody. Get your mind right. You don't have to settle. Get your mind right. You don't have to come down to their level. Get your mind right. Know who you are in God. Know that you are God's beloved. I wish I had somebody here. You don't have to have foolishness and craziness and all kinds of stupid stuff all up in your life. The devil is a lie. Get your mind right. You're more than a conqueror through Christ Jesus.
Amen.
Get your head on straight. You can do all things through Christ Jesus, who gives you strength. Amen, somebody. Get your head on right. Hallelujah. Get back in your Bible. Get back on your knees. Go back to fasting and praying. Hallelujah. Get sin out of your life. Find the right church. And get some stuff that's on your mind off your mind. And get some stuff that should be on your mind on your mind. Like your mission. What are you here for? Why did God call you? Why did he save you? Whose lives does he want you to touch? What has he anointed you and appointed? You need to have your head on your mission. Hallelujah. If you had your head on your mission, you wouldn't be worrying about what you're going through. Amen. Hallelujah. Come on, give God a praise right now. Get the best gift that you can get in your hand, whatever the Lord may lay on your heart to do tonight. Hallelujah. I need you to sow liberally tonight. I pray that I was able to answer everybody's questions. Hallelujah. Whatever God lay in your heart to sow, give and it shall be given.
Amen.
Press down. Shaking together. Running over. Hallelujah. Shall men give unto your bosom? We praise God for all that the Lord is doing in this season. Hallelujah. What a mighty God we serve. Amen.
Wake up.
All right. Hallelujah. Is everybody sold? Everybody given?
Yes, sir.
Hallelujah. We thank God for each and every one of you. I pray you got a word tonight.
Amen.
Amen. Hallelujah. Don't forget, amen, this coming Sunday, amen, it's going to be a powerful Sunday, so invite everybody that you can out for morning worship, amen. And then on the 27th is our Victory Fest, amen, a taste of victory. And I think we're going to be start. What time we start? 9 o'clock, 10 o'clock? 9 o'clock, amen. So be here, amen. We're going to have hot dogs and all kinds of stuff, amen, going on that day. So it's going to be a wonderful day in Jesus' name. Amen. And so just keep me in prayer. September the 4th, all my leaders know that you're going out with me.
Yes, sir.
September the 4th. Did I send out that communication to everybody?
Yeah.
No? I told you about it? All right. Remind me to send you a text with the flyer and all that kind of stuff. Amen. All right. Come on, put your hands together and give me praise. Father, we thank you. We praise you tonight. We ask, oh God, in the name of Jesus, God, as we leave this place but not your presence, we thank you for your word. In Jesus' name, we thank you for your anointing and for the power of God to rest upon your people. In Jesus' name we pray. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
Thank God. Clap those hands one more time. Greet your neighbor. Hallelujah.